I want to touch on a subject called projection. With the problems occurring with the hurricane in several states, Donald Trump is infusing people's minds, the people that listen to him, the people on Fox News, and he have all these other parrots repeating that things like the Biden administration is not helping the Republican areas of the states that have been inflicted all with all this damage at all. And he's making mention of all these types of issues, which are patently false. They are lies. And with Trump, what you notice is the things that he said, you know, he on a campaign train now, he's saying, if Kamala Harris is elected, it's the end of democracy, and you will lose the freedom to speak, the freedom of the press, etc. All these things he's saying. And I want everybody to keep in the back of their minds that magical word called projection. Because as he speaks, much of what he's saying is the way he feels, the things he does. The classic example is talking about not helping certain areas of the country. As every Republican governor and senator in the destructed areas have said so far, working with this administration was not simple. It was easy. In fact, it's not only that they had to reach out to the administration for help and support. The administration called on them before they called the administration. The administration called, Biden called the governor of Georgia before the governor of Georgia called him to ask, how can I help? The governor of Georgia called back and said, thank you for the help. I'll let you know as it goes on what I need. The Democratic governor of North Carolina said the same. The Republican senator of North Carolina said the same. DeSantis, no favorite of the, no Biden lover, said the same thing, even as he refuses right now to take calls from Kamala Harris, who wants to know, how can I help? A big storm, one bigger than expected, one bigger than forecast, is about to hit Florida in the Tampa area. You know, Florida has been getting a lot of hurricanes, but they've been lucky. Florida has a lot of areas in the Big Bend, in the Bend portion, that isn't very well populated. So if you notice, most of the damage from this last Hurricane Helen has been found in the mountains of North Carolina, places that don't expect hurricanes or the results that hurricanes can leave inland. They don't expect that, but they got hit harder than did Florida, because Florida got hit in the best regions, those best regions being unpopulated areas. Well, they may not get this lucky this time. Tampa has been getting to the left and the right of hurricanes over the last several years, but haven't been taking direct hits of strong hurricanes. And now it seems like their luck may have run out. As I see what is happening in Tampa, I fear for Houston, Texas, where this broadcast emanates from. Why? Because the damage a direct hit would give to us would make whatever direct hit that goes through Tampa pale in comparison, because it wouldn't only mean destruction for much of the shoreline in the Houston metropolitan area, meaning Pasadena, meaning all those areas where we have a ton of oil refineries that pump gas through pipelines throughout this country. We are talking about the massive failure of our energy and economic system. If we get a direct hit and water goes up the ship channel and destroys shipping, destroys the oil refineries, etc. Again, because of climate change, because of poor regulations to protect us in the case of a disaster. So disaster is about to hit upon Tampa, in that area, with the same sensibility we should have for what could happen to Houston next year. Houston, a much bigger city. Houston, a much more important city from an energy standpoint, from a shipping standpoint, etc. So for all of those that are listening to my voice right now, elected officials, both on the state level, we have the organization that controls our energy sector. I can't recall the name of it right now, both environmentally and regulatorily here in Texas. And we should ask the important questions. Are we ready? Does the election of people who believe in science versus rhetoric matter? I started the discussion with projection, because that's what we get from a whole lot of our Republican politicians, day in and day out. And we have Donald Trump again claiming that somehow the response is party-based. We have the Republican governors, senators, etc. of the affected states saying otherwise. But what we have now is evidence that Donald Trump, with his projection, is actually not, we won't have to say he would do that. We can say that we know for a fact he contemplated doing that. Politico reports the following. In the aftermath of Hurricane Helen, former President Donald Trump has blasted the Biden administration for its handling of the disaster, going so far as to accuse Democratic leaders of ignoring the needs of Republican storm victims. That's a lie. Now, we know that's projection. How? But a review of Trump's record by Politico's E&E News and interviews with two former Trump White House officials show that the former president was flagrantly partisan at times in response to disasters and on at least three occasions hesitated to give disaster aid to areas he considered politically hostile or ordered special treatment for pro-Trump states. Mark Harvey, who was Trump's senior director for resilience policy on the National Security Council staff, told E&E News on Wednesday that Trump initially refused to approve disaster aid for California after deadly wildfires in 2018 because of the state's Democratic leanings. But Harvey said Trump changed his mind after Harvey pulled voting results to show him that heavily damaged Orange County, California, had more Trump supporters than the entire state of Iowa. Only after he was convinced that, hey, there are Trump voters that are being affected, did he say, okay, I will go ahead and assist. Another one, they love me in the panhandle. In 2019, shortly after taking office, Governor Ron DeSantis met with Trump at the White House to ask a favor. Months earlier, while DeSantis was running for governor, Hurricane Michael had caused massive damage in the Florida panhandle. DeSantis asked, would the president order the Federal Emergency Management Agency to pay 100% of the recovery cost instead of its customary 75%. This is Trump country, and they need your help, DeSantis told the president, according to the Republican governor's autobiography, The Courage to be Free. They love me in the panhandle, Trump replied, according to DeSantis, book pushing in 2023 as he was preparing to run for president. I must have won 90% of the vote. There are huge crowds. What do they need? On March 2019, Trump signed an order directing 100% of most disaster costs in Florida. As a result, FEMA paid roughly $350 million more than it would have without Trump's intervention. Again, an area they voted for me, I am going to change the law and I'm going to give you 100% of the coverage. But less than 2 months earlier, Trump threatened to veto a disaster aid measure in Congress that would have FEMA pay 100% of all disaster costs in Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands after Hurricane Maria killed more than 3,000 people. The White House said in January 16, 2019 policy statement that it strongly objected to the proposal. Cost shares are critical to ensure that work with impacted jurisdictions is collaborative and that both partners have incentives to operate efficiently and control costs, the Trump Office of Management and Budget wrote. The legislation failed in the Senate. So as you can see, it is projection when he talks about other governors trying to somehow base their support on whether people voted for them or not. It is Trump who did that. It is Democratic administrations like Biden and Obama's. Remember Obama's embrace of the New Jersey governor, Chris Christie, which almost got Christie in trouble because, again, He hugged a Democrat. He showed some humanity. So folks, who you elect matters. If you elect super partisanship politicians that only lie to you, it matters. There are several of them going around the country right now, lying to you about illegal immigrants eating cats and dogs to create friction. They're threatening people with legal immigration status to throw them out of the country. They're threatening right now to go ahead and do all of these things, not just to immigrants, but to you. And what do I mean by to you as well? Well, as you know, there is climate change, and we have the partisan Republican elected officials choosing to disregard it, to make believe it doesn't exist. And their votes reflect that. And if we take a look at their votes, we'll say, well, it doesn't matter if they say these things because we know the government will be there for them. Well, FEMA needs money now because the disasters are getting more massive. And so we pass bills to do that. Well, let's get clear here. There's a list that who voted against FEMA relief before Helen battered their home states. Several Republicans that many Republicans elected voted against the interests of those who elected them. My question to all of you who voted for your state reps, who voted for the people who are representing you in Congress, who voted against your best will, what should be there to protect you? Do they deserve your vote again? Let's get clear. North Carolina, I'm going to make sure to name you the people. Again, we're listened to all over, not only live, but in podcasts. So I want you to open your ears here, people. These are people who voted to say, let's not give you a penny if a disaster hits you, even though these are the same people that are voting to protect those industries that are exacerbating climate change, that are exacerbating the things that affect you most with both pollution, with weather, with regulations that ensure that these corporations won't dump crap in your creeks, won't pollute your groundwater. These are the same guys. So let's get started. North Carolina, who voted against it? Senator Ted Budd. Who voted against FEMA? Dan Bishop, North Carolina 8th District. In South Carolina, another hard hit area, Representative Jeff Duncan of the 3rd District in South Carolina, Russell Fry of the 7th District in South Carolina, Nancy Mace of the 1st District in South Carolina, Ralph Norman of the 5th District in North Carolina, and William R. Simmons in the 4th District of South Carolina. They said with that vote, you shouldn't get a penny. And at the same time, their master, Donald Trump, is saying, hey, you're not getting the money that you deserve after these guys voted against it. In Georgia, Richard McCormick, representative from Georgia District 6, Marjorie Taylor Greene, you know, MTG, 14th District in Georgia. Are you going to elect that mouthpiece again after she voted by saying, my district gets affected by the weather? Don't give us any money. Mike Collins, Georgia 10th District. Andrew S. Clyde, Georgia 9th District. Okay, Florida is about to get plastered by yet another hurricane, less than 3 weeks apart. But Danielle Weber from the 11th District said no to FEMA. Michael Waltz from the 6th District says no to FEMA. Bill Posey from the 8th District said no to FEMA. Corey Mills from the 7th District says no. Anna Paulina Luna from the 13th District says no to FEMA. Laurel M. Lee, Florida 15th District, says no to FEMA. Matt Gaetz, the guy who has been accused for underage messing with kids, 11th District. Byron Donalds from Florida, the 1st District. Kat Kamak, Florida, 3rd District, voted against FEMA. All these people that I'm naming voted against FEMA. Gus M. Bilirakis, Florida, 12th District. Aaron Bean, Florida, 4th District. Rick Scott, the Senator Rick Scott of Florida, abstained, refused to vote. In other words, he did not vote for FEMA. Your senator did not vote for FEMA, yet they are begging for monies as it comes, the storm effects comes to them. Tennessee and Representative Tim Burchett, Tennessee 2nd District, Andrew Ogles, Tennessee 5th District, John W. Rose, Tennessee 6th District. Okay, let's talk about Tennessee senators now. Marsha Blackburn voted against FEMA. Bill Haggerty, senator, voted against FEMA. Both senators from Tennessee voted against the support of their people that they represent. Will you, the representative, the people in those states, send these people who denied your interests, voted against your interests, continue to vote against your interests, not just because of FEMA, but because of policies that would mitigate climate change, but because of policies that would mitigate polluting your groundwater, voting against policies that would mess with your farmers. But because of ideology, you just blindly support these people. We are, it's the, our government is we the people. Our government represent who we are. Our government is a snapshot every 2 years of who we are. And if they're telling you who they are with their vote, maybe we should all start listening. Maybe that's why Texas actually just may make a turn this year and start voting in the aggregate. I'm not talking about just Harris County, but if you start looking at the polls, people may start voting again in Texas by hook or crook. Texas may become the state, that progressive state in voting before anybody expected. Will that be the case? It will be the case if you go out there and do your job. It will be the case if one starts to vote their interest. Folks, stop being hoodwinked. Your vote matters. Those people in Tampa, Florida are going to see that their vote mattered because they have Joe Biden and Kamala Harris in office. There is a funded FEMA that will protect them. It will protect them as they are devastated by the storm. It'll protect them because they have the right administration in power, because they have a responsible administration in power, because they don't have those who will just project, but those who will execute. And come November, you have to decide if you're going to play that crazy game called ideological politics, the politics of who you think you support, as opposed to those who will support your interests, those who will vote your interest. It is time to wake up. It is time for you to say, you know what? I will do the right thing. This isn't black and white. We have votes. We have policies that we can see in action. We have in West Texas, we have oil bubbling out of the ground and polluting groundwater. We have pools of sludge coming back to the surface because our EEQC is not doing its job. These are things that when they fail because of lack of regulation, appropriate regulations, cannot be mitigated when it's too late. We are responsible for the government we elect. And with that, let's go to our first call.
We spend a lot of time deconstructing the news, trying to parse it into a form that everybody can understand. We try to find those little nitpicks where it flies above the fray, etc. If you really like these videos that we do, I want to ask a big favor. Please go ahead, number one, subscribe to our channel, and number two, please join if you can. Thank you so kindly for watching. Keep watching. Please remember to share. We must populate the entire internet with our progressive message, a message that we know is what most Americans say that they want. So help us, please join.